Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Sky Tonight program. This is Seth Mayo again, curator of astronomy for the Lohmann Planetarium. And in this week's episode of the Sky Tonight, we're covering the dates of March 8th through March 14th. And what we'll take a look at is that nice planetary gathering that's still going on in the early morning, but the moon will be joining in. So we'll take a look at how that all looks like together. Then we're going to talk about the second brightest star in the night sky, Canopus, if you're in more of a southern latitude. We can take a look at where that star is and what constellation it is part of. And at the end, we will mention again daylight saving time that's coming up on the 14th. So let's get to it. If you've been getting up early in the morning before sunrise lately, you still have a chance to see a whole bunch of planets just above the east and southeastern horizon. And if we look here, we can see some of those planets. This is on the morning of the 9th. And you can still see Mercury is the one lowest, the smallest planet in the solar system. Then the largest planet, Jupiter, just above it to the right, and then Saturn. And if you recall from last week's episode, we talked about the morning of the 5th, March 5th, when Jupiter and Mercury were really close to each other. They had come to a conjunction, so that was quite nice, but they have moved apart very quickly. Mercury does not stay in the same place for too long. It moves around the sun very, very fast. And as it does so, it moves across our sky very fast as well. So you can notice those changes. What's really nice is that the moon will have entered the scene by the morning of the 9th. And you'll see it as a very thin, waning crescent moon. I love when the moon is a crescent shape like this. And joining these other planets, it makes for kind of a nice solar system lineup. Maybe a bit of a curve with these four objects. But quite nice to see them all together in the same area. Now, if we go to following mornings, you'll find the moon will continue its path across the sky as it goes around the Earth. And as we get to the morning of the 10th, you'll see the moon will be an even thinner crescent and a little closer to Jupiter here. Jupiter, you'll notice, will be the brightest out of the three planets. Jupiter is just so large and reflective. And just keep in mind, the moon will be very tough to see at this point because of the sun's glare that is nearby. And even more so, the following morning on the 11th, you'll see the moon will have dived even further into the sun's glare, making it really challenging to see by this point. But there is still an opportunity to see it. You just have to have all the right conditions, a very clear view of the sky, no obstructions in your way towards the east and southeast. So that would be quite nice. But you'll still have a chance to see Mercury, Jupiter, and Saturn. So for these next couple mornings, at least the beginning of the week here, you'll have a really nice grouping of these objects with the moon nearby. And if you are a picture taker, photographer, you might get some really nice shots of these objects together. As I mentioned in last week's episode of The Sky Tonight, I talked about the celestial highlights in March, and I briefly discussed a star that I don't always get a chance to talk about. And that is a star very low in the south, the one we call Canopus. Now, here in Florida, we're in a more southerly latitude. If you're in a more northerly latitude here in the United States or elsewhere around the world, you won't have a chance to see this. But if you do find yourself in a more southern location on Earth or in the southern hemisphere, you will have a chance to see this very bright star. And this is the second brightest star you can see in the sky. And when it comes just above the horizon in the south, it really is noticeable, and I love looking out for it at this time of the year. Now, normally when we're talking about bright stars, especially the brightest star, we're usually talking about the star Sirius, which truly is the brightest star. There is no other star in the sky that comes close to the brightness of Sirius, and Sirius is so easy to spot. Orion the Hunter, especially his belt, the three stars in a row point right to it. And Sirius is among some really great winter stars and constellations all around it, and for the spring as well. But I don't always get a chance to talk about Canopus, which is quite a bit below it down here. And even though Sirius is so much brighter than any other star, the one that comes closest to it is Canopus right there. Canopus is actually a very bright star by itself, though. It's much farther away than Sirius. Sirius is only 8.5 light years away, while Canopus is more than 300 light years away. If you put these two stars next to each other, Canopus would outshine Sirius by a whole bunch. It's about 15,000 times brighter than our sun, anywhere from 60 to 70 times bigger than our sun. It's at the end of its life. It's running out of fuel in its core. It's already burned through its hydrogen, now in its helium burning phases. And it's hotter than the surface of our sun. Our surface of our sun is about 10,000 degrees or so. The surface of Canopus is about 13,000 degrees Fahrenheit. So it makes it whitish in appearance versus the yellow star that is our sun. But what makes Canopus so interesting is the history of its name and the history of the constellation it finds itself in. So let's head down to the southern hemisphere to give us just a better look at this area of the sky. So now we find ourselves in the southern hemisphere, and you'll notice very quickly that Canopus is way higher above the southern horizon than we were just looking at. And you'll also find some other things that look a little different too. Being in this part of the world, you'll find that Orion, there's Orion's Belt, and the brightest star Sirius are really high in the sky, almost at the zenith pretty much at the latitude that I picked here. So things look a bit different for us that live in the northern hemisphere, so it's kind of cool to see the difference here. But anyway, let's head back to Canopus right here. So Canopus is part of the modern day constellation we call Carina, which is part of a ship constellation, a much larger one. This is the keel of the ship, or the hull of it. So these stars make up kind of the basis of this sailing ship. And so I'll turn on the picture as well, just to kind of give us a better idea of what we're looking at here. Sometimes these things can be quite challenging, right? Now, the rest of the ship also has various parts here. The sails are represented by a constellation called Vela, that we'll find here. So there's Vela, the sails. In the rear section, or the aft of the ship, we have stars that make up Pupus, or Puppus, which is the poop deck. It's always a fun one. So here's the poop deck section there. And if we look a little higher up, this is not really part of the ship, but it does kind of belong in this area and then sort of associated with the ship. And that is a very small constellation here called Pyxis that you find. That's the compass. So sailing ships and compasses definitely go hand in hand. So you notice where Canopus is located. A lot of times it represented the rudder, at least the aft end of this ship. And this used to be one large constellation called Argo Navis. And that really means Argo's ship. And going back to ancient Greek mythology, this ship was part of a sailing mission by the Argonauts, who were named after the ship itself. And the Argonauts, along with someone named Jason, were trying to find and retrieve something called the Golden Fleece. Jason was trying to be king, and he needed this fleece to give to the king he was basically trying to replace. And this is the very famous ship that was used for that mission. And hundreds of years ago, this was considered one very large constellation. Again, it's called Argo Navis, long ago, and that was hundreds of years ago. And at the time, it was by far the biggest constellation, or at least the one that had the most stars within it. Eventually, astronomers and cartographers thought that this was just too messy and there was just too much going on. So eventually, it was actually split up into the constellations I mentioned earlier, into Carina, the keel, Vela, the sails, Pupus, the poop deck, and again, Pyxis, the compass, as separate constellations. But many still include it as one large grouping of stars that form the ship of the Argonauts and Jason. And going back to the star Canopus right here, Canopus may be named after the pilot of the ship from those stories. The name's actually been changed over the years. In many ways, it was called Canobus, and over time, it was changed to Canopus. And another explanation for the name may come from Egypt, because in that part of the world, observers saw the star low in the south, just like we do here in Florida, and they noticed the star had kind of a reddish appearance as you saw it through more of the thicker atmosphere, and they had a name for it. At least the Coptic name was Kahi Nub, which kind of has a connection to Canopus, and that means the golden earth, because of the reddish golden color that the star would exhibit since it was very low in the horizon. So that's another possible explanation for Canopus, either Egyptian or Greek, just depending on the history here. But nonetheless, it's still quite an interesting star, again, as the second brightest star in the night sky, part of a very large constellation with a lot of interesting history. And it's always fun when it just peaks just above the horizon for us in our part of the world. By the end of the week, I just want to remind everyone again that daylight saving time begins, and this happens on March 14th, actually occurs at 2 in the morning. And this is when we spring forward an hour. I also like to remember that since this starts in March, that we march forward an hour. And then in the fall, we fall back an hour when daylight saving time ends on November 7th this year. And what you'll notice, of course, is that our sunrise and sunset will occur an hour later. So you will notice that instead of this happening in the 6 o'clock hour, it will happen in the 7 o'clock time frame. It will get darker later, and that means the objects in the night sky will be seen at a later time frame as well. So you will have to make that adjustment in your schedule, both in the morning and the evening. And I know you do lose an hour of sleep, which is unfortunate, but the rationale that's been given for many years is that due to what was a typical 9 to 5 or 9 to 6 workday, which may have changed due to the pandemic, but due to that workday in the past, changing clocks for daylight saving time would give more daylight for folks after work, which meant more activities after work, maybe even boosting the economy a bit more, maybe even some energy savings happening as well. But some of these reasons are being debated upon and studied and questioned if they really actually have an effect on those things. And we are finding that our circadian rhythms are being affected by even an hour change. And the circadian rhythm is very important to our health. So making that change can affect the sleep schedule in certain ways for many people. So this depends on who you ask. And there is a bit of a debate going on in countries and municipalities around the world. Some places are getting rid of daylight saving time, or they're keeping the time change for daylight saving time, just keeping it where it is, and just not ever changing the time back and forth ever again, just to keep it simple. So it just depends. But many places around the world still observe this time change, including the United States. Most states do this, with the exception of Hawaii and Arizona. And sometimes more southerly locations decide not to enforce daylight saving time, because in those places, if you're closer to the equator, daylight doesn't change as much throughout the year or throughout the seasons, as opposed to the very northerly or southerly latitudes. So some locations, it doesn't really matter that much. But if you do live in an area that observes it, just remember to move your clocks forward an hour. I know many clocks these days will do it automatically. But of course, you know, you may have that stove or microwave clock, or even that pesky car clock on your radio or dashboard that is so easy to forget and put off. That's something I always have a problem with, changing the car clock. But we will make that change, and even with this new schedule change, we will continue to observe the skies as we usually do. So I just want to sneak in one more thing in this episode. I've been talking a ton about the red planet Mars, and you'll notice it moved a little past the Pleiades star cluster. It's a little closer to the V shape, or the nose of Taurus, the bull that we see here. And Mars is still within that constellation. But as I've been mentioning in the last few episodes, that Perseverance rover that just landed on the surface, I know I sound like a broken record. I've been talking about this over and over again, but I can't help myself. It's so cool to have a new perspective on Mars from a different location. And I just want to share with you a few new photos that were released by the rover and give you an update on what's going on with Perseverance. So here is one photo I particularly enjoy from Mastcam Z, and this is a raw, unedited photo from NASA's website. They are really cool. They have a website that allows you to download the images that are fed from the rover back to Earth that are unedited and unaltered, so you can manipulate them and change them and use your own editing skills to pull out the details of these images, which is so great that they're allowing the public to do this. They've been doing it with Curiosity as well. So this is one image that's raw and unedited, And it's amazing to see the detail here. And just to know, again, that's the planet Mars. And the resolution is really great. The color looks awesome. And you can see the edge of some of the mountains and maybe even part of the river delta here, I believe, we're seeing in this photo, which is so, so cool. Here is another image I really enjoy. And this is a zoomed in shot of an image of a little hill or mound on Mars. And just so cool to see the rocks on the surface there. And I know for a geologist or planetary scientist, they're probably aching to look at these types of things, go up close to them, and kind of figure out what's going on in this part of Mars in what's called the Jezero Crater, where scientists think they could find ancient forms or at least past signs of microbial life. It's amazing to see the diversity of these different shots here. And the last photo I just want to show you is exciting one for the rover itself, because you notice the track marks on here, kind of to the right side and curving to the middle of the image there. They just started to drive the rover around a little bit. They've been doing a lot of instrument checks since landing on February 18th, making sure everything's working, moving some of the instruments, taking a whole bunch of pictures, and they finally got the rover to move around a little bit to make sure its driving abilities are intact after the long journey to the planet. And you can see the tracks there. And so this rover is gonna be driving a ton. You gotta make sure everything is working. So that was an exciting moment. This picture was taken from March 4th when the rover was first driven about 21 feet. And it's neat to see the tracks left by the rover on the surface of Mars. So when you're looking at Mars still in the sky, keep thinking about that mission and what we might find as we continue to explore the planet. That's it for another edition of our Sky Tonight. Thank you so much for tuning in. And if you find yourself in Daytona Beach, please stop by the Museum of Arts and Sciences. We have so many wonderful exhibits, either permanent or temporary, that are on display. And of course, check out our Lohmann Planetarium. We are running shows daily and on the hour, and we're running them safely. So we'd love to see you there at some point. But with that, thank you. Take care, and of course, happy stargazing.